We are being recorded and live streamed on EUhealthyworkplaces website, so I'm just letting you know. Don't be worried. You haven't got to stand at the front and face the camera like I have, so I have more to worry about. And during the session, we will have three times where we will ask you to vote, and we will ask you to vote on questions that we're going to give you. Oh, sorry, there's three. So we have Spanish, German, and English. So there's your channels. And if we could go on to the next slide. Oh, no mobile phones. Right, does everyone switch their mobile? My mobile phone went off at a talk I was doing the other week, so I've double-checked, but I think I'm okay. But if you can switch your mobiles off, that would be good. Otherwise, your mobiles will also be broadcast across the internet, so you probably don't want that. Okay. Next. Okay, well, my name is Peter Kelly. I'm the Good Practice Jury Chair for the campaign. I work for the Health and Safety Executive, and I've been a psychologist with them for 17 years. 15 of those years has been spent working in stress and mental health. I've grown up with this area, and I continue to get up every day and feel inspired to do stuff because we have the opportunity to manage a risk within a workplace through the management of stress. And this campaign has been a great example of what countries and organizations can do when they think about how they're going to tackle psychosocial risk within the workplace. We are in the 21st century. We have a condition that can be managed and prevented, not eradicated, by implementing good practice in psychosocial risk. I want to go to work and come home from work feeling fulfilled and feeling as though I've done a good job. I shouldn't come home from work and feel depressed or anxious or not able to spend time with my family. So this psychosocial risk is a hugely important area for any developed nation or any nation that we look after people. Shortly, we're going to have some presentations from some of the award-winning companies that were part of the Good Practice Awards. Examples of sustainability, creativity, impact, productivity, where actually if you look after the people that you employ, they will look after you. It's a simple message, isn't it? If we look after people, they'll look after the company. Companies that look after people show higher productivity, lower absence, reduction in sickness absence, and engagement and high levels of commitment. All of these are admirable and things that we need to have in any effective company. In recognizing good practice, the jury was looking for genuine and effective management of psychosocial risk and work-related stress. We were looking for workplace diversity that being taken into account, participation and involvement of the workforce and their representatives, demonstrable improvements in health and safety, sustainability of interventions over time, and importantly, transferability to other workplaces, including to those in other member states, to small and medium-sized enterprise. On the panel that we have here, we are actually missing two representatives from Triglav. They've been delayed on their plane, but they are due to arrive. So they are going on last, and hopefully they will arrive. I mean, if they do arrive, and it's midway through our discussion section, we'll probably try and bring them in to do their presentation. So before I hand over to our first speakers, and I think the first speaker is, oh no, before we hand over to any of the speakers, we've got an interactive bit. Now in front of you, you have a voting pad. Shortly, you're going to get your first question coming up. When you see this question, I'll read it out to you. you'll see a bar that will move along the bottom for approximately 10 seconds. You have to press a number during that 10 seconds to get the feedback to vote on this question. So we're all clear about that. So the voting pads will come on, but do not press your number. Oh, if you don't have one, hands up if you don't have one. Oh, okay. Somebody's going to try and pass them around to you very quickly. Excellent. How are your flights? Did everyone have a nice flight over? No? Did you feel the Bill Bauer bounce as you came into the airport? Okay. I think we're nearly there. You can keep hold of them as well until the end, because we've got another two times that we'll be doing voting. Okay, so have you experienced symptoms of work-related stress? So this one, you answer either one, two, or three, and that should start now. And go, one, two, or three. Okay, so hopefully this is a well-informed audience then. So 87% of you said that you've experienced stress. That's quite common in any of the, when we do this with audiences, actually, this is a common thing that impacts people. Next one, please. What is the greatest source of stress for you at work? Colleagues, managers, time pressure, physical working conditions, and shortly, one to four, pick one, go now. Okay, 51% for time pressure. 31% of you have, were your managers and colleagues. Okay, time pressure, excessive demands. Welcome to the plight of the 21st century. This is where, you know, we commonly see higher and higher and higher loads of people are given extra work to do, and actually they're not able to do it because it's far beyond their capability. So, good. And the next question, does your organization have a policy and an action plan to prevent work-related stress? Yes or no? Okay, 38% yes, 68%, 62% no. If I was a teacher, I'd say that would be a must improve because it should be the other way around and it should be higher than that. We should have policies and action plans to prevent work-related stress. With that, what I'd like to do now is hand over to our first speaker, who is Keld, and he's from Lands and Spar. And he's going to talk about the health and well-being work that they've done in their bank.
Thank you very much. Thank you for the opportunity to share with you what we have been doing in our bank recently for the last 5-6 years when we started. Just to put in place, we are a bank. A full-size bank that are located in Denmark in the heart of Copenhagen, having 20 branches around Denmark, 150,000 customers, and around 400 employees. We call ourselves a full-service bank, which means that we have private customers and we have organizational customers and business customers. So we practically can work with everything. Yes, looking at our program, Bank in Motion, we have to go back to 2008, where the debt crisis was starting. We had a bank where who didn't earn any money. Our surplus was a great zero, and there was some crisis in the area around the bank. So the board decided that we should have a new vision, a new mission, and a new strategy. And they handed in a new CEO to make that happen. While working with this new strategy, the new vision and the mission, we realized that we had to put a lot of pressure. We had to work harder and smarter. So talking about how should we do that, it was clear to us that it could be quite hard for our employees. And one of the goals from the board was that we should also increase the well-being, and we should also increase the customer's satisfaction with working in the bank. So a part of the business plan, a part of the strategy was increase the well-being. We started the program called Bank in Motion, a sustainable process. We wanted our people to come to the bank with motivation and energy to work every day, and we also wanted them to leave the bank with the heads above the head, energized, to go back and be something for the society, be something for the family and so on. So that was the main target. We wanted to improve people's life and motivation. The goals was that we should increase the productivity and the efficiency so that we actually could accomplish the goals in the business strategy. Just for an example, an average counselor in the bank had 0.6 meetings a day. At 2013, they should have 2 meetings a day. So we had to put a little pressure on. Another goal was the increase in well-being and job satisfaction. We wanted to be among the 25 best companies in Denmark. We should establish low absenteeism and also work with the physical part. So we wanted people to be energized, to make some change in habits so they physically also could handle the pressure. So we basically wanted to make people physical and mental robust to accomplish the goals. Our strategy in Bank in Motion was that we have had an anchor. We were anchored in the board, so we also had the CEO on and the rest of the board of directors. So instead of letting ambassadors in the bank work with the environment, we wanted the management to be responsible for taking actions. Also, we wanted to empower people to know what to do, how to handle stress situation, how to handle the work pressure, find out what am I really good at it, and what should I not do that much of, and let someone else do it. And instead of giving the responsibility to the Work Environment Council, we decided that it should be a part of the business strategy, it should be a part of the organization, so the anchor was in the HR department, who was responsible for taking actions so that we could accomplish our goals. I think one of the main reasons why we succeeded is it was a part of the business strategy. We had the anchor on the board, we had the anchor at the top level management, and that's very important for achieving what we wanted to do. Looking at what did we do, we had bets on all levels, looking at the individual, the group, the management, and the organization level. Bank in Motion is a part of the leadership development in the bank. That means, for instance, all our managers and leaders are certified business coaches. They also have an extra module where we talk about lifestyle coaching. So if an employee comes to the manager and wants to have help quit smoking, losing some pounds, he can also coach on that one. A part of the process is that we have developed some team tools. I'll get back to one of them. I've actually taken one with to show you. Every employee in the bank is offered an annual health check. Together with the health check, we also make a survey every year, and we can cross the data from the health check and from the survey and be able to put in some actions where we can see it makes meaning. We don't believe in needlestick operations. For instance, I don't believe in if you have a coach or a consultant to come and tell you about mindfulness for an hour and a half, then nobody will do mindfulness after a week. I think that if you do something, go totally into it. For instance, our lose and win sequence It's a program for 4 or 5 months where we meet with the participants once a week, every Wednesday. We meet with them, and they meet some specialists. It could be a chef who teaches them how to cook the right food. It could be a fitness instructor who takes the participants to the fitness gym and works together with them. And then they will go again 14 days after just to make sure that they know how to do. We have also introduced the well-being conversations. If you are away from work 3 days, then we will take this well-being conversation just to make sure that it's nothing about the leadership, about the team or something, so we can handle it if there's something wrong. So we have made a lot of efforts to actually work with the well-being. I'll get back to the good life. So what we think is important for creating well-being is we want the leaders to take action. We want people to take action for themselves, both on the health and the mental part, and then, of course, about the team, the work environment that they are part of. Looking at this, this is one of the team tools that we have introduced. It's very simple, it's very easy to duplicate. After the survey, we look at the results, and we find approximately 20 questions that we need to ask, that we can see there's something in for the teams. We give them these 20 cards with questions on, and we make a small workshop in every department, every branch. They sit around the table, looking at the cards, picking out 5 that they really want to work with. For instance, it could be about how we're talking to each other in the department. They have this discussion, and then they put in a dot, where are we today at the well-being compass? And where do we want to be? If there's a gap, they have to make an action plan. They have to make a plan and set up some goals, find out who's responsible, when do we evaluate, and what are the actions to be taken. So they work with this 2 times a year, just after the survey in May, June, and then again in October, November, to evaluate how does it work, did we achieve what we wanted to do, or do we need to do more? And we have trained the managers to facilitate this workshop. The last thing that I will take here is the Good Life, which is a course that everyone in the bank have the opportunity to go to. Starts with the individual health check. Afterwards, that when you enter to the program, you make an energy log of what makes me happy at work. What am I good at? What are my strengths? What should I do more of? What motivates me? If I have a bad day, what was the reason that I had a bad day? And then they meet on the training day, work with the energy log, found out what should I do, what is my strength, and come back to the chief, to the manager, and say, hey, I'm good at this, I should work more with this, and less with this, we have to find someone else who has strength on that part. So in that way, we know that people actually can be 200% better at what they're good at, and only 50% better at what they're not that good at. So why not just focus on the strengths? Afterwards, then they have another 14 days working with another lock, the lock of the good life. What makes me happy? What are my happy moments? What do I want to achieve? And so on. And then on the second training day, we work with that. And we make a plan. It could be that you should go home and have a workshop at home together with your family to make a vision. Could be that you should sit down, find out what do I want to achieve in my life? What about the things that I really want to do. And finally, we have this one-on-one session with our psychologist who makes the plan proper and makes it work for the individual. Looking at the results from this, we can see that 50% a year after has still made a habit change. So it's quite effective. So we do this every year. We start up in April, making the survey, the health check, we plan it. We implement the new ideas, the new things that we have to work with, evaluate to see how to do it, try to improve it, and then again, year after year since 2009. And what have we achieved by it? As I told you, in 2008, we didn't earn any money. We had a goal about 100 million in 2013. We reached it in 2012. The productivity has gone up. The number of annual sick days per employee were 8 days when we started the program. Today it's 4 days, 3.9 actually. Habit changes, more exercise in the work. Looking at the customer satisfaction, we are now number 3 in Denmark. The great place to work was the place that we wanted to be among the 25 best. When we started, we were number 69. After a year, we became number 71, going up, but in the wrong direction. But the year after, we went down to number 24 and ended up as number 20. Finally, the employee satisfaction today is 93% satisfied or very satisfied. So something is working, and we'll continue with the work. Thank you.
At the end of all the presentations, we're going to have an open panel discussion. And during that time, if you want to ask questions, you can ask questions directly. But if we could move on to the next presentation, this is by Andreas. Andreas is from Deutsche Post DHL. And he will stick to the 12 minutes, just like Keld did. Thank you very much.
Peter, thank you for the introduction and the hint regarding the 12 minutes. Because of this and the fact that 25 of the colleagues here in the room take the headsets, I spontaneously decide to go on in German. Perhaps this is better to stick to the 12 minutes. So nochmal herzlichen Dank für die Einladung. Na, jetzt geht's, okay. Deutsche Post DHL Group, ein sehr spannendes Unternehmen, mittlerweile das größte Logistikunternehmen weltweit. Das Spannende dabei ist, dass unsere Wurzeln in 1490 liegen, also eine Firma, die permanent Änderungen unterlegen hat. Sehr spannend bei uns auch nochmal der Angang, dass jeder Mitarbeiter in einem Logistikunternehmen ganz wesentlicher Teil auch einer Logistikkette ist. Das heißt, jeder Mitarbeiter eben ein Schlüsselglied in der Logistikkette ist und dementsprechend auch jedem Mitarbeiter klar ist, wie wichtig der einzelne Job im Unternehmen ist. Ich zeige Ihnen jetzt einige Charts an dieser Stelle, die wir auch verwenden im Rahmen der Management Education oder auch in den Gesprächen mit unseren Betriebsräten und genauso auch mit unseren Mitarbeitern, um zu vermitteln, wie wichtig die Bedeutung des Themas Gesundheit, insbesondere des Themas der psychischen Gesundheit und der Prävention von psychischen Erkrankungen ist. Wir sehen weltweit, das wissen Sie alle, dass wir insbesondere 5 bzw. 6 große chronische Erkrankungen haben, die rapide zunehmen, interessanterweise in allen Ländern aus unterschiedlichen Gründen. Einmal demografische Entwicklungen in Ländern mit jungen Erwachsenen, das Thema auch Verwestlichung von Lebensgewohnheiten über Ernährung und andere Lebensstile. Aber wir sehen, dass wir eben weltweit ein großes Risiko haben zum Thema der Depressionen, muss ich Ihnen gar nichts mehr sagen zu den Zahlen, die uns hier betreffen. Was wir aber sehen, ganz massiv, ist, dass die Unternehmen aus zwei wichtigen Punkten eben ganz wesentlich in Prävention investieren sollten. Das eine ist das Thema, dass wir natürlich als Unternehmen selber daran interessiert sind, möglichst produktive Mitarbeiter zu haben, die Produktivität, die Leistungsfähigkeit, die Gesundheit der Mitarbeiter zu erhalten. Und auf der anderen Seite, dass die Unternehmen weltweit eben auch das größte Präventionssetting sind. Und wenn man jetzt mal guckt, der Michael Porter, der ursprünglich den Gedanken der Corporate Social Responsibility entwickelt hat, hat diesen Gedanken zum Teil widerrufen und gesagt, wir müssen heute was ganz anderes machen. Wir müssen die Unternehmen heute auffordern, einen Beitrag, einen gesellschaftlichen Wert zu liefern, und zwar durch ihre ureigene Tätigkeit und nicht durch das grüne Bäume pflanzen irgendwo. Und dementsprechend sind alle Investitionen, die wir in die Prävention, in die Krankheitsprävention im Unternehmen betreiben, auf der anderen Seite eine ganz klare Investition in Risikomanagement, in den Erhalt eben von Produktivität und auf der anderen Seite gleichzeitig eine Investition auch in die Gesundheit oder in die Fähigkeit der Gesellschaften, eben die Herausforderungen in der Zukunft bewältigen zu können. Denn die Frage, wie wir in der Zukunft auch Behandlung von Erkrankungen, die Pflege finanzieren sollen, ist eine weitgehend doch ungelöste Frage. Wir haben, das ist immer sehr spannend in der Diskussion mit unseren Managern, wir haben natürlich sehr häufig vorgebildete Menschen in Führungsstrukturen, insbesondere im Bereich der Betriebswirtschaft, die eben aus der, die sozialisiert wurden, eben aus den Wirtschaftswissenschaften. Man kann jetzt böse fragen, ob das Thema Wissenschaften immer damit zusammenhängt, weil die Wirtschaftswissenschaften zum großen Teil eben auf dem Konstrukt des Homo economicus basieren, den es so nicht gibt. Also es gibt nicht den egoistischen, rationalen oder ausschließlich rationalen Menschen, der zur Arbeit geht, um wenig zu tun, um möglichst viel Geld zu verdienen, aber das ist häufig eben in der Edukation eben auch von Führungskräften ein Modell, was erstmal in der Universität gelehrt wurde, dass wir also entsprechend nochmal dem man entsprechend widersprechen muss. Es ist eher umgekehrt. Natürlich sind wir alle daran interessiert, die Sicherheit, die Existenz der Familie eben entsprechend gewährleisten zu können durch ein entsprechendes Grundgehalt. Aber der nächste Schritt ist schon, wir wollen in einem Team interagieren, wir wollen das, was wir gelernt haben, einbringen können, Arbeit gestalten können und wir wollen letztendlich dadurch Bestätigung und auch Respekt im Unternehmen erfahren. Das leitet auch nochmal über zum Vortrag morgen von Professor Sigrist. Das ist bei uns auch ein Kernchart, was in unterschiedlichen Weiterbildungen genutzt wird. Wir wissen bei der Arbeit, dass es drei Arten von Belohnungen gibt, eben die Gehaltserhöhung, die Möglichkeit, Karriere zu machen oder Jobsicherheit und eben das Thema entsprechend Wertschätzung zu erfahren, das Danke, das Lob am Arbeitsplatz zu erfahren und nur das ist ein Motivationsfaktor. Wenn wir eine Gehaltserhöhung haben, nach 2 Jahren ist die eigentlich das Standard. Dann haben wir uns daran gewöhnt, dann erfahren wir das nicht mehr, aber das Danke jeden Tag zu hören oder jeden zweiten Tag oder nach gut getaner Arbeit ist ein immer wiederkehrender Motivationsfaktor. Und das Spannende auch immer wieder in der Diskussion mit Führungskräften ist, nochmal klarzumachen, dass das subjektive Empfinden von uns, von unseren Mitarbeitern entscheidend ist. Nicht das Objektive, erstmal der objektive Hintergrund, sondern wenn wir uns subjektiv schlecht fühlen, wenn wir uns nicht gewertschätzt fühlen für unser Engagement, dann resultiert das letztendlich in der Verdopplung des Risikos an einer Herz-Kreislauf-Erkrankung zu erkranken, beziehungsweise einer depressiven Störung zu erkranken. Nächstes Thema, Stress. Jetzt haben wir schon, Peter, ich denke mal, das Thema zum Beispiel UK, die Definition von Stress in UK ist eine andere als in Deutschland zum Beispiel. Deswegen ist für uns die Herausforderung, es mal klarzumachen, auch weltweit klarzumachen, wenn wir mit Managern sprechen, wie ist für uns die Stressdefinition. Das ist erstmal eine neutrale Anforderung. Stress brauchen wir alle, um uns entwickeln zu können, weiterentwickeln zu können. Hätten wir keinen Stress, würden wir eigentlich letztendlich retardieren. Aber wir müssen letztendlich gucken, können wir die Anforderungen, die an uns gestellt werden, mit den entsprechenden Ressourcen, sei es Bildung, sei es Arbeitsmittel, eben erfüllen. Spannenderweise ist es umgekehrt, eben so können wir es nicht, wissen wir eben wissenschaftlich abgesichert, dass die Risiken, an einer Depression zu erkranken, muskuloskeletale Beschwerden zu haben, Herz-Kreislauf-Erkrankungen zu haben oder auch einen Diabetes zu entwickeln, dadurch massiv ansteigen. Und wenn man nochmal vorne guckt, was ich vorhin gesagt habe, die globalen Erkrankungen, also das Thema arbeitsbedingte Erkrankung und globale Erkrankung ist deckungsgleich. Auch das ist nochmal ein Zeichen, wie wichtig das Präventionssetting der Unternehmen ist. Ich muss mal gleichzeitig mal auf die Uhr gucken. Deswegen haben wir, jetzt war ich zu schnell, erstmal auch angefangen zu definieren, was ist eigentlich auch Gesundheit? Weil wenn Sie mal gucken, welche unterschiedlichen Gesundheitsdefinitionen es in der Welt gibt, häufig in den Unternehmen sehr utilitaristisch geprägt, auch politisch sehr spannend, auch in den deutschen Ministerien finden Sie häufig Sätze, nur gesunde Mitarbeiter können motiviert und kreativ arbeiten. Dann ist immer die Frage, was ist jetzt Gesundheit an der Stelle? Und man muss sich eben davon lösen, dass die Belegschaften heute durchgehend gesund sind. Wir sind nie gesund. Gesundheit ist kein Kontinuum, sondern ist dynamisch. Wir waren nicht mal bei der Geburt gesund. Die Frage ist nur, wie viel gesund sind wir? Der Antonowski, der Erfinder der Gesundheitsförderung, in Anführungszeichen, der sagt letztendlich, solange wir noch am Leben sind, muss ja irgendwas von uns noch gesund sein. Also auch, das ist auch die Frage umgekehrt, was ist gesund, wie lange sind wir handlungsfähig? Deswegen haben wir für uns nochmal definiert in Anlehnung an die Weltgesundheitsorganisation und die Ottawa- und Bangkok-Charta, dass Gesundheit eben nicht die Abwesenheit von Krankheit ist, sondern dass für uns entscheidend ist, auch als Arbeitgeber zu schauen, dass wir den richtigen Arbeitsplatz für unsere Menschen mit ihren entsprechenden auch Erkrankungen haben, weil ein Großteil von uns mit zunehmendem Alter auch das Risiko von chronischen Erkrankungen hat oder umgekehrt eben die richtigen Mitarbeiter am richtigen Arbeitsplatz zu haben. Also zur Gesundheit gehört dazu, eben letztendlich auch ein wirtschaftlich und sozial erfülltes Leben führen zu können. In 2008 haben wir etwas für unser Unternehmen Revolutionäres gemacht. Wir haben unser Set von Corporate Values in der Kommunikation sehr vereinfacht in drei Worte: Respekt und Resultate. Das ist unsere Corporate Guideline im Unternehmen und das heißt, wir wollen gute Resultate erzielen. Das wollen wir aber nicht ohne Respekt tun. Das heißt, nicht ohne Respekt gegenüber unseren Mitarbeitern, nicht ohne Respekt gegenüber den Führungskräften, nicht ohne Respekt gegenüber Kunden und unseren Shareholdern. Das klingt jetzt erstmal ja auch relativ banal, aber das hat etwas in Bewegung gesetzt, insbesondere einen Kommunikationsprozess in Bewegung gesetzt, der dazu führt, dass auch die Mitarbeiter diesen Satz auch immer wieder auch einfordern, sich auch trauen, entsprechend in konfliktbehaftete Situationen zu gehen und Dinge anzumahnen, weil sie sich hier auf eine einfache Grundlinie berufen können. Das heißt, es hat auch etwas mit Kulturwechsel zu tun, auch letztendlich Fehlerkultur, Fehler erlauben, auch letztendlich Leute zu ermutigen, Verantwortung zu übernehmen, weil Logistik ist ein extrem innovatives Business und Sie wissen selber, Innovationen werden sehr häufig über die Mitarbeiter selber getrieben und weniger über das Management. Das Management setzt dafür nur letztendlich die Rahmenbedingungen. Wir haben das entsprechend auch ein Repertoire an entsprechenden Führungsleitlinien, an den Ethikleitlinien. Für uns wichtig ist, oder auch nochmal hier in der Darstellung wichtig ist, dass wir natürlich auch unsere Betriebsräte entsprechend beteiligen. Wir haben seit 1997 ein Managementsystem zur Gesundheitsförderung, wo wir entsprechende Steuerungskreise in jedem Betrieb haben und die arbeiten eben seit 1997 sehr gut. Wir haben jährlich konstant um die 40.000 Gesundheitsfördermaßnahmen alleine in Deutschland, die über diese Arbeitskreise gesteuert werden. Und das ist nicht nur das Thema psychische Gesundheit. Aber in 2013 haben wir auf Basis des WHO-Modells der gesunden Arbeitsplätze eine Strategie entwickelt, eine Health Safety Wellbeing Strategie, die einfach klar machen soll, wo sind letztendlich die wesentlichen Themen, wo sind die Aktivitätsebenen, was sind die wesentlichen Handlungshebel mit dem höchsten Return on Invest, um systematisch den größten Krankheitsrisiken im Unternehmen begegnen zu können. Und Sie sehen, dass das Thema mentale Gesundheit sehr zentral steht, weil es natürlich immer was mit der Unternehmenskultur, mit der Arbeitsplatzgestaltung und der individuellen Resistenz oder auch Veranlagung zu tun hat. Seit 2004 bedienen wir uns, das ist für die in Deutschland sehr früh gewesen, bedienen wir uns einer systematischen Untersuchung, einer Gefährdungsbeurteilung, einem Risk Assessment zum Thema psychische Belastung. Das ist das sogenannte SALSA-Tool. Das ist eine der vielen Möglichkeiten, ein entsprechendes Risk Assessment zu machen. Das Spannende hierbei ist, dass man hier schaut, wo sind letztendlich die gesundheitsförderlichen Anteile bei der Arbeit, wo hat man letztendlich Defizite oder was kann man verbessern. Also die positiven Aspekte von Arbeit herauszuarbeiten, herauszukristallisieren. Das ist insofern sehr wichtig, weil wir gelernt haben, dass man hier auch sehr gut mit den Mitarbeitern hinterher diskutieren kann. Was kann man verbessern? Das Gefährliche ist ja, wenn man eine Analyse macht und plötzlich sagen hinterher zwei Lager, das ist alles ganz anders und man bewirft sich gegenseitig mit Vorwürfen. Das ist mit diesem Tool nicht so. Und ganz entscheidend ist ja auch nochmal, es geht auch hier auf die subjektive Befindlichkeit der Beschäftigten ein. Es gibt einen großen Widerstreit, muss man objektiv messen oder subjektiv, aber wir wissen ja letztendlich, es kommt auf die subjektive Befindlichkeit als erstes an. Nächstes Thema ist, wir beteiligen unsere Mitarbeiter systematisch auch zum Thema Arbeitsplatzgestaltung, zur Gestaltung von Arbeitsmitteln. Sie sehen hier unseren E-Scooter einmal vor einigen Jahren, eben hier noch dieses Modell in weiß und rechts daneben das Modell heute im Praxisbetrieb. Sehr spannend, wir haben damals mit vielen Automobilunternehmen gesprochen, ob die mit uns so ein Fahrzeug entwickeln wollen. Das wollten sie nicht, mittlerweile sind wir jetzt auch ein Autobauer. Und dieses Auto wird jetzt mit mehreren tausend Exemplaren hergestellt und ist auch schon im Alltagsbetrieb und wurde immer wieder mit den Zustellern nochmal korrigiert, sodass es ein optimales elektrisches Zustellfahrzeug ist. Das Gleiche gilt für Fahrräder, entsprechend für Kleidung und weitere Arbeitsmittel. Da ist immer unmittelbar auch der Rückschluss zu unseren Mitarbeitern gefragt. Wir haben natürlich auch das Thema der Mitarbeiterbefragung, die wir jährlich durchführen, weltweit jährlich durchführen. Und wir haben, was Sie in der Mitte gerade sehen, mit dem PEP-Button. Wir haben ein sogenanntes Hupsala zum Anhalten tippen. Meine Zeit ist vorbei, aber ich bin auch fast durch. Stress durch, ne? Durch Smartphones. Wir haben ein sogenanntes Certified-Programm. Das heißt, in jeder Unternehmenssparte wird jeder Mitarbeiter, also wir haben, wie gesagt, weltweit 480.000 Mitarbeiter eben geschult zum Thema der Unternehmensstrategie. Aber letztendlich auch geht man in einen Diskurs. Was sind die Herausforderungen für die Zukunft? Wir bauen gerade ein entsprechendes Certified-Modul zum Thema Führung und Gesundheit und wollen das danach dann auch für alle Mitarbeiter entsprechend ausrollen. Wir hatten vor einigen Jahren ein sogenanntes webbasiertes Training entwickelt, Leadership in Mental Health. Aus dem Grund heraus, dass unsere Führungskräfte weltweit, wir sind ja ein nicht organisch gewachsenes Unternehmen, das hatte ich vorhin schon mal erwähnt, aus unterschiedlichen kulturellen Hintergründen kommen. In diesem Trainingsmodul erklären wir nochmal unser gemeinsames Verständnis von psychischer Gesundheit, von den dahinterliegenden wissenschaftlichen Modellen, gehen auf die psychische Gesundheit der Führungskräfte selber ein, also auf die Stressoren der Führungskraft, wie kann ich damit umgehen, gehen darauf ein, wie ist letztendlich die Verantwortung der Führungskraft gegenüber den Mitarbeitern, welchen Einfluss hat Führung auf die Gesundheit der Beschäftigten und erklären letztendlich, welche Verantwortung hat die Führungskraft und wo endet die Verantwortung auch, wo muss man entsprechende Experten einsetzen, wer steht zur Verfügung und am Schluss ist dann natürlich auch nochmal unser CEO gefragt, im Hinblick auch auf unsere Corporate Guideline, Respekt und Resultate. So, damit sind wir auch schon am Schluss. Letztendlich, also wir haben ja unendlich viele Veranstaltungen zum Thema psychische Gesundheit, wir diskutieren das Thema Digitalisierung der Arbeit, Arbeiten 4.0, Industrie 4.0 und irgendwie hat man den Eindruck, es ist unheimlich komplex, gesunde Arbeit zu gestalten und das ist es eigentlich nicht. Gesunde Arbeit ist Arbeit, die sich an unseren psychologischen Grundbedürfnissen orientiert und im Kern ist das eine Arbeit, die erstmal fair bezahlt sein muss, die in einem supportiven Umfeld stattfindet, wo wir unsere Arbeit verstehen können müssen, wo wir die Arbeit bewältigen können müssen, wo wir die Arbeit gestalten können müssen und letztendlich auch Sinn in der Arbeit finden. Wenn das der Status ist, dann brauche ich auch gar keine anderen Programme mehr mit dazu. Wir brauchen aber heute noch Programme, weil häufig die Arbeit nicht entsprechend gestaltet ist, aber das bleibt eine Herausforderung und wir werden immer besser. Vielen Dank fürs Zuhören. Und eine Bitte noch, heute Abend würde ich gerne die beiden oder die 6% kennenlernen, die gesagt haben, dass sie noch keinen Stress erfahren haben am Arbeitsplatz. Vielen Dank.
Thank you very much. Only 14 minutes.
Okay.
That's okay. Okay, now we have Lars from Siemens and possibly Yvan as well, if I'm generous. I haven't decided yet.
So, weil der Kanal schon auf Englisch umgestellt ist, mache ich gleich so weiter wie mein Vorredner. Schönen guten Nachmittag, sehr verehrte Damen und Herren. Mein Name ist Lars Hoffmann, ich bin Leiter der Abteilung Sicherheit bei der Siemens, sitze in München. Und ich möchte Ihnen in den nächsten Minuten einen ganz kurzen Eindruck darüber vermitteln, wie wir bei Siemens das Thema Psychosocial Risk Management bei uns in die Gesamt-EHS-Strategie integriert haben. Aber bevor ich da einsteige, noch mal ganz kurz ein kurzer Überblick über unser Unternehmen. Wir sind rund 340.000 Mitarbeiter weltweit und Sie sehen an den Zahlen, dass es da nicht wirklich Schwerpunkte gibt. Wir sind also wirklich rund um den Globus verteilt und das bringt natürlich als global agierendes Unternehmen mit einer, sag mal, Matrixstruktur gewisse Herausforderungen auch im Gesundheits- und Risikomanagementbereich mit sich. Da gibt es Herausforderungen, die sind eher globaler Natur. Da gibt es aber genauso gut Herausforderungen, die sind mehr regional angesiedelt, die sind landesspezifisch oder die können auch sogar standortspezifisch sein. Und umso wichtiger ist es, dass wir, wenn wir uns um das Thema Health Management oder Psychosocial Risk Management insbesondere kümmern, keinen Ansatz fahren, so nach dem Motto Prinzip Gießkanne, one size fits all. Die Erfahrung haben wir gemacht, das wird nicht funktionieren, das heißt, wir müssen uns, wenn wir uns diesen Herausforderungen stellen wollen, jeweils auch die lokalen Bedingungen berücksichtigen. Wir dürfen nicht vergessen, dass wir in den unterschiedlichsten Regionen und Ländern dieser Welt unterschiedlichste, ich sag mal, Umgebungsbedingungen auch vorfinden werden. Da spielt das Thema Ausbildung eine Rolle, da spielt das Thema Lebensstatus eine Rolle, da spielt das Thema Ernährung eine Rolle. Ja, wir haben Mitarbeiter, die leben in sogenannten Wasserstressgebieten. Auch das ist ein Thema, was man berücksichtigen muss. Wir haben unterschiedliche Sozialsysteme in den unterschiedlichsten Regionen der Welt. Und all dieses zusammen macht es letztendlich aus, was halt die Charakteristik der einzelnen Region noch ausmacht. So. So, nichtsdestotrotz haben wir gesagt, auch wenn das so individuell ist, brauchen wir ein globales Framework, einen Rahmen, den wir vorgeben, um dort in die richtige Richtung zu lenken. Und als ersten Schritt haben wir gesagt, okay, dann macht es natürlich Sinn, dass wir alles, was zum Thema Health Management bei uns getan wird, auch mal entsprechend bündeln und nicht so nach dem Motto, da macht einer was und auf der anderen Seite macht jemand was. Die Schnittstellen werden oft nicht berücksichtigt. Das wollten wir nicht und deswegen haben wir gesagt, zunächst werden erstmal alle Aktivitäten unter einem Dach gebündelt und hier sehen Sie, wie wir global zu dem Thema EHS aufgestellt sind. Wir haben natürlich die Kollegen vom Umweltschutz dabei und wenn es insbesondere um das Thema Health Management bei uns geht, dann sehen Sie schon, wir haben Unterbereiche, die sich mit dem Thema Health Promotion befassen. Das sind die Leute, die halt operativen Support an den einzelnen Standorten geben. Wir haben Medical Services, das ist klassischerweise der Arbeitsmediziner und das zugehörige Personal. Aber wir haben auch, um es insbesondere transparent zu machen, hier das Thema Psychosocial Health and Wellbeing mit integriert. Das ist nicht nur für diese Folie so, das haben wir bewusst gemacht, einfach um anzufangen, aktiv über das Thema zu kommunizieren und es auch im Konzern transparenter zu machen. Und dann haben wir natürlich die Safety-Seite, die ja auch sehr häufig Schnittstellen zum Health-Management-Bereich hat. Grundsätzlich nochmal als Erinnerung, das wird nichts Neues für Sie sein, Arbeit ist ja per se nichts Negatives, auch wenn manch einer vielleicht der Auffassung ist, ja immer wenn ich zur Arbeit gehe, geht es mir schlecht. Grundsätzlich ist es so, dass Arbeit wichtig für uns ist. Es gibt dem Leben eine gewisse Struktur, es gibt eine Stabilität. Ja, es sichert unseren Lebensstandard letztendlich auch. Es bringt uns in ein soziales Netzwerk, wir gehen in den Kontakt, in den Austausch mit anderen und so weiter und so fort. Also dies einfach noch mal zur Erinnerung, Arbeit ist per se grundsätzlich nichts Negatives, sondern im Gegenteil, wenn es gut organisiert ist und richtig angefasst wird, ein positiver Faktor, der essentiell für uns ist. Jetzt komme ich nochmal darauf zurück. Ich hatte gesagt, wir wollen einen Rahmen vorgeben und der findet sich in der Regel darin wieder, dass wir, oder in den Safety- und Health-Management-Systemen wieder, und da unterscheiden wir unter anderem in zwei Bereiche. Wir haben einmal das Thema Psychosocial Risk Management, ja, vielen auch schon bekannt, weil es ja auch oftmals gesetzlich gefordert ist, allerdings nicht in allen Ländern der Welt. Da fokussieren wir uns wirklich nur um die Working Environment, um das Umfeld, ganz wichtig. Hier geht es noch nicht um das Individuum. Ja. Also Psychosocial Risk Management ist ein Teil davon, beschäftigt sich vornehmlich mit der Arbeitsumgebung und den Arbeitsbedingungen. Und wir haben einen zweiten Teil, den nennen wir Leben in Balance. Der kümmert sich dann wirklich insbesondere um das Individuum. So, zum Thema Risk Assessment, ganz kurz, wie wir das machen. Vielleicht haben wir hinterher noch die Zeit, da ein bisschen näher drauf einzugehen. Also wir haben da weltweit einen einheitlichen Ansatz gewählt, aus vielerlei Gründen. Wir nutzen den Global Engagement Survey bei Siemens dazu, um erste Informationen zu sammeln. Gibt es eine Indikation auf mögliche, Belastungen im Arbeitsumfeld? Das heißt, es gibt dann einen Sonderreport, den wir aus diesem Survey ziehen können, pro Führungskraft und pro Abteilung. Und dann kriege ich schon mal eine erste Hausnummer, gibt es da Bereiche vielleicht, um die ich mich mal kümmern sollte. Wenn alles in Ordnung ist, dann kann man sagen, nein, bei mir ist wirklich alles gut gelaufen, ich muss mich da nicht im Detail drum kümmern. Dann mag das so sein, aber es gibt sicherlich auch den einen oder anderen, der dann erkennt, ups, da gibt es eine Abweichung und da sollte ich vielleicht mal ein bisschen mehr Aufmerksamkeit schenken. Das heißt, wenn dann dieser Sonderreport gezogen ist und ich identifiziert habe, da gibt es, Bereiche, wo man sich verbessern kann, dann geht man in eine sogenannte zweite Phase. Erste Phase ist halt die Orientierungsphase, ja oder nein. Und die zweite Phase geht dann ein bisschen mehr in die detaillierte Analyse. Und da gibt es verschiedene Möglichkeiten, das zu tun. Das kann man in der Abteilung selbst mit den Mitarbeitern vielleicht direkt besprechen. Dann gibt es die Möglichkeit, über einen Social Counselor bei uns, Social Counseling, also Sozialberater mit einzubeziehen. Da gibt es die Möglichkeit, Betriebsräte mit einzubeziehen oder auch externe Consultants oder Coaches mit einzubeziehen. Und dann legt man gemeinsam, nachdem man halt die Details analysiert hat, wo klemmt es denn wirklich, wirklich für diese Abteilung Maßnahmen fest. Und jeder kennt das, wenn Sie Maßnahmen identifiziert haben, dann sind die nur so lange gut, wie sie effektiv sind. Das heißt, der nächste Schritt wird dann sein, in einem angemessenen Zeitraum diese Maßnahmen sich anzuschauen, gemeinsam entsprechend zu dokumentieren und auch zu kommunizieren. Also das ist ganz grob so der Prozess, den wir bei uns global einheitlich verankert haben. So, zur Unterstützung haben wir unterschiedlichste Möglichkeiten. Wir haben beispielsweise eine sogenannte Recommended Practice, also eine Handlungsempfehlung herausgegeben, die weltweit allen Führungskräften oder auch Mitarbeitern, Führungskräfte sind auch Mitarbeiter, aber die allen Mitarbeitern zur Verfügung stehen. Wir haben in Deutschland insbesondere eine Betriebsvereinbarung für das Rollout von psychischer Gefährdungsbeurteilung gestellt. Wir haben ein E-Learning-Modul zur Verfügung gestellt, wo sich Personen halt vertraut machen können mit dem Thema. Und wir haben zusätzlich noch eine sogenannte Toolbox, also eine Werkzeugkiste bereitgestellt, aus denen sich halt die entsprechenden Einheiten weltweit auch bedienen können, je nachdem, was angemessen ist. So, ich hatte schon gesagt, der zweite Part dreht sich dann mehr um das Individuum. Da reden wir über Leben in Balance. Klar, das ist eine freiwillige Geschichte, da soll und kann auch niemand jetzt zu irgendwelchen Maßnahmen verpflichtet werden, aber wir bieten das entsprechend an. Und abgedeckt wird das Ganze oder implementiert wird das Ganze über unser weltweites Programm Healthy at Siemens. Das ist ein sehr systematisierter Ansatz, wo wir, ich sag mal, eine definierte Vorgehensweise festgelegt haben, die aber sich nicht auf inhaltliche Aspekte beschränkt oder fokussiert. Das war uns ganz wichtig. Ich hatte es eingangs gesagt, unterschiedlichste Anforderungen, unterschiedlichste Bedürfnisse. Da kann es nicht sein, dass wir zentral irgendwelche Maßnahmen vorgeben. Ja, das, ich kann jetzt nicht sagen, alle Einheiten weltweit geben grüne Äpfel aus und dann geht es allen Leuten gut. Oder alle machen nächstes Jahr mal eine Rückenschule oder bezahlen einen Beitrag für das Fitnessstudio. Das wird nicht funktionieren. Das heißt, es muss auf die jeweiligen Bedürfnisse vor Ort zugeschnitten sein. Und das ist genau der Ansatz und das ist auch genau der Erfolg dieses Programms. Wir hatten bei einem Parallelprogramm zum Thema Safety, das nennt sich Zero Harm Culture at Siemens, in den Piloten das auch mal vor, so nach dem Motto, das ist jetzt das, was wir, ich sag mal, als das Nonplusultra erachten und ihr müsst es jetzt mal implementieren. Und wir haben beim ersten Piloten schon gemerkt, das funktioniert so nicht und das kann es auch nicht sein. Und wir haben dann gesagt, das ist die grobe Marschrichtung, das sind die Leitplanken und innerhalb der Leitplanken müsst ihr euch entsprechend bewegen. Und eins ist auch sicher, wenn Sie etwas zentral vorgeben, werden Sie nie die Akzeptanz bekommen, als wenn Leute vor Ort selbst etwas entwickelt haben. Gut, ich hatte gesagt, dass dann jede Organisationseinheit das Programm selber inhaltlich zuschneidet. Und hier sehen Sie einfach mal ein Beispiel. Ich gehe jetzt nicht auf die einzelnen Inhalte ein, aber das sieht dann halt bei jeder Einheit ein bisschen unterschiedlich aus. Und hier sehen Sie mal ein paar Beispiele von Ländern, die das sehr erfolgreich gemacht haben. Ja, wir haben ja den Kollegen aus Belgien hier noch dabei. Vielleicht haben wir nachher noch die Zeit, ein bisschen darüber zu reden. Und ja, ansonsten war es das erstmal soweit von meiner Seite. Also das war wirklich sehr komprimiert, wie wir bei der Siemens das Thema Psychosocial Risk Management in der Gesamtstrategie verankert haben. Vielen Dank. Peter, do we have the time for this, or do we want to make it afterwards?
I think you can probably do it in a minute. You got about four slides.
Fine.
do you want to do the last four slides very quickly?
And I would like to ask my colleague to do so.
He's going to do the. We're going to do his slides in the. In the question session. So
okay, then yeah. That's fine. Then we're finished.
Okay, okay. Cheers. Thank you very much. Okay, we're running to time. It's a very good thing. What we're going to do now is I'm going to come up and I have another set of questions to ask you. After we've asked these questions, we're going to have a panel discussion. So I will start off by asking a couple of questions to the presenters, and then I definitely want you to ask them questions as well, because the ones I'm asking, they've been prepared for. The ones that you're asking, they won't have been prepared for, and it would be good for you to be able to participate in this interactive session. So I'm just going to go up to the microphone. Okay, back to the interactive bit. Have your devices ready. Oh, nearly lost them. Okay, have you been involved in managing psychosocial risk? So you can answer this as a manager, as an expert, as an employee, on a political level or not yet. So one answer. And go. Okay, so that's quite a broad range of responses, and that probably accurately reflects a lot of people's own personal experience. Moving to the next set of questions here, because we're feeling generous, we'll give you two options rather than one, because we think that you would prefer two options. So managing stress and psychosocial risk in the workplace is difficult because of lack of awareness amongst management, lack of awareness amongst workers, stigma around mental health, fear of losing a job because of raising the issue, or it is not difficult. When the line comes up, and go. Two options if you want. Okay, so lack of awareness amongst management is one of the biggest issues that arises, and it's fairly clear cut, isn't it? That actually, even now, with all the information and everything that we have out there, managers are not informed, or we perceive that they're not informed. The reason for this campaign was to inform managers, and the legacy from this campaign must be that we carry that on. So it's interesting that's, and also there still exists a stigma around mental health. Mental health is a common problem. It's why we call it a common mental health issue. One in five of us will experience depression or anxiety. In this room, a number of us have experienced it. So we do not need to feel stigma around common mental health problems. Next question, please. Oh, and we'll give you two on this as well because we're feeling generous. What is the best way to convince management of psychosocial risk prevention? Present the business case, e.g. higher productivity, less absenteeism, good practice case studies from other organizations, remind of a moral duty, fulfilling legal obligation or maintaining company reputation. And you can choose two and start voting now. That's excellent. So present the business case and good practice case studies from other organizations. Both of these you find in the literature, and we're confident actually that these are it, they do have impact. The interesting one is managing company representation. When you talk to organizations when they've had a set of stress cases, they'll say that the company's reputation has been impacted and affected. So it actually, there is an element there of using that also. Actually, you want your best people to be working for you, don't you? And you want the best people out there that are not working for you to work for you. So company representation is really important. In the top companies to work for in the Times 500,
the top 100 all have health and well-being in place. They all manage psychosocial risk. High productivity, low staff turnover. This is really, it's an important part of presenting the business case. Okay, that's the end for now. We got two more questions at the very end. But what we're going to do now is to move into an open discussion section. I'm just going to go back there. Keld, are you ready? You ready? Good, okay. When you were implementing the change in your work organization to address high workload and demands, how did you go about doing that?
As I mentioned in the presentation, we started up with the strategy work and made up some goals to make people more effective and productive. And looking at how to maintain people at work, we implemented the different kind of tools that actually makes people's well-being go up. I don't know if that's answered the questions.
Yep, that's good.
Thank you.
We might come back later. Does anyone have any questions about Kel's response? No? Yes? Okay. Very good. Andreas,
yes.
Can you tell me about the role of the management and managers in stress prevention, particularly the role of the corporate culture, which is self-evident through your presentation that was comes out very crystal clear?
Yes, it depends on the corporate culture and the intrinsic motivation of the management. Because when we just discussed how can we convince management, we try to take a vehicle like the business case, the reputation, and we know don't argue with moral duties or obligation. But in fact, it is a question of ethics and morals, and it is a question of a business case of productivity, but it is both. And so we really appreciated the clear words of our CEO in 2008 when he just said, don't let us work with this kind of complicated corporate values, or let us work with these corporate values, but let's them make easier with respect and results. And I think the message is very clear. Respect each other in the work. And we will be successful. This does not mean that we are working very, what is kuschelig, stress-free. Which we have a lot of debates on the question how to survive in the future in a very competitive surrounding. But this basic topic or this basic guideline, respect and results, is still the rule for the discussions, and the people are really courageous to ask also the management, the normal employee in brackets, is very often tough enough to ask the management to follow the rules and the other way around. So you need the corporate culture behind, otherwise the people will get ill. If you send the message is always we're doing the right things, we have the right programs, but the strategy behind is we want to earn money as easy as possible, then the people will get ill afterwards.
So if corporate culture is very important as in terms of what it sets the basis of how the organization is going to respond, how did you find when you developed the employee participation in work design? Were they naturally engaged straight away, or did you have to do a process of engagement to people to believe you were going to do what you said you would do on work design?
No, I think this is very easy. On one hand, we have a central approach to design the workplaces which are comparable in the company. But we learned this is not enough, because we have to convince our people and to engage them with their knowledge in designing the working place. We need both. And so when we start the discussion, and last year I made a big project where we discussed with executives, with employees, and also works councils on workplace design and questions, what is a healthy workplace? You see, the people are really engaged and really willing to send their message to engage in the workplace design. You only have to ask, and you need a kind of systematic approach to analyze all the good ideas afterwards. But it's not a question to engage people in the workplace design.
Okay. Is that your experience as well, in terms of workplace design, or either Lars?
I can't add something. This is also our experience. Yeah.
Okay. Excellent. Lars, if you thinking about your work, if you look at how did you address your worries about job insecurity?
Well, this is an interesting
question. During a recession, it's something that's inherently there, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, one thing is clear. Working in a global organization like we are means there are ongoing changes. So this is not a stable organization. That means we have to be very sensitive on this topic, and we have to pay much more attention like we probably did in the past. This is very important. And just for your information, you may know it from the newspapers, we had a huge reorganization during the last couple of months, which means we got rid of the sector layer within Siemens, and it is very important that you are prepared on time how you deal with this topic. And the key for success, from my perspective, is the right information to the workforce at the right time. Otherwise, people they get afraid, they get disappointed, and finally they get demotivated at the end of the day. So you lose them. You lose them if you don't communicate from the very beginning what your intention is as a corporation, where the strategy goes, and how the final structure will look like at the end of the day. And what we offer during this period, for instance, is we offer social counseling, especially, and we did it during the last reorganization. So people had the chance to either individually talk to social counselors, or they came together in groups and had some kind of moderated workshops so that they are not feeling alone. And all these kind of things need to be well prepared. This is not just something you take out of your cupboard and put it on the table. It is really sensitive. And on the other hand, one should know that we also hired 33,000 people during the last year, which is also a challenging thing and needs to be prepared. So the reorganization and maybe headcount cutoff is one thing, but also the integration of new people is another story. And you need to focus on the topic.
Yvan, can you talk a little bit about Siemens' focus on prevention and the strategies that you've used there?
Sure.
As well? Because that would be...
So there are a few examples. One of them is that we have training sessions organized for managers, so stress management for managers, in which they can learn how to detect stress and stress-related situations with their employees, what they can do. On the other hand, we also initiated an employee assistance program. That's an external firm to which all employees can address if they have personal problems at home. Because stress is not only on the work floor. You got stress also in your private life. Sometimes you bring it back to the work, vice versa. And sometimes it becomes a cocktail of problems and stress-related physical problems. So this allows people to anonymously talk to professionals face-to-face or on the phone and talk about their problems. This is free of charge. This is open for every employee of Siemens Belgium, and also every member of the family can also contact these people. Just in case that if someone has a long absence due to a burnout or another disease, we try to reintegration to improve it by assisting the person, not by when first day when he's coming back to his work to throw him back for the lines. Just to gradually make him integrate again in his job, to facilitate him, and also to avoid that he's got a setback after a few months. All this stuff, it works. Both sides is a win-win, because no one needs an employee who has problems and who after 2 months comes back too early because he's afraid of losing his job, he's afraid of having repercussions by an employer. Sorry. So it's better that he has healed completely at the moment that he comes back, and that he can gradually step in without a lot of stress or without a workload waiting for him to start again and get back on his track. What we also try to do in the near future, because the job isn't finished yet, we have some more challenges waiting ahead of us. But with big challenges mean also big opportunities. That's to invest in people. As you know, wherever in Europe, we have to work longer. So we have to make work workable. So you have to invest in people, invest in your human capital. And you can do this by giving some extra training, not leaving someone in a job for 20, 25 years. So there are a lot of stuff that we still can do, but I think we're on the right track for building a better future and better working conditions at Siemens.
Excellent. Keld, can you talk a little bit about the Bank in Motion, in the program, particularly the role of managers in work-life coaching, because that's something fairly unique within the financial sector.
Yeah. Well, looking at what we have been working with together with the employees, making them empowered and make them be aware of their own body and their own mind, it came out that they needed some kind of help. So what we thought of was, couldn't we use the knowledge that we already had as coaches? We were good at business coaching, knew how to do that. We worked in a theory of positive psychology. So we talked together with our advisors to see, can we make some kind of extra module so that they couldn't become lifestyle coaches? And yeah, we could. So we took all the managers, all the leaders into to a new session and worked together with them to make them lifestyle coaches. So if people come from the health check and say, hey, I want to lose some pounds, can you help me? They can actually help by helping with the coaching and so on, go together with them and make them accomplish it. And also after working with the Good Life, when people come back, they can also walk into that room without fear and help people. It means that you have a lot, you need to have a lot of trust, because it will be very intimate things that you talk about, so it could be quite a challenge to go through that border. But I haven't heard of any problems about it, so I think trust is a main thing here, respect about people and that we actually do this to help people. And I think Yvan's point is very good, that that stress is not something that you just get from your work. It's all over. But at the end of the day, you won't be home, go home and put a sticker on the refrigerator saying, Dad needs to have totally silence in the home so that he could go to work. It's always the other way around, and then we have the absenteeism. So I think that we have, as professionals, we need to take actions. We need to be responsible about teaching people, teaching employees to handle the workload, both back home and at work.
Do you think as a consequence of that, you have better working relationships between line managers or managers and employees?
Yeah,
I don't know. Does it feel very natural rather than...
It feels very natural, and it's a very flat organization. Everybody uses each other to talk to each other. And for instance, bullying is another problem that can come up. And if we have it in the survey, we help people working with it in the department. So you can't just go directly and say, are you the one who is bullying? But we can talk about how is the conversation in this department? How do we help each other? And so on, build up the respect to try to put it down.
Because one of the things you find is, okay.
Now, just to add something, if you say the collaboration between managers, line managers in workforce and other stakeholders, there are some more, and you were talking about talking to each other, that means they have to talk the same language in terms of contents. And this is where I have some doubts. And probably we will come to the topic stigmatization of psychosocial topics per se. For me, one of the key drivers for the stigmatization is still a lack of knowledge, a lack of information, and finally, a lack of communication. I had an experience recently when we in Germany started to roll out the psychosocial risk assessment. When we, let's say, contacted the line management, when we informed them about it, about the deployment, and in the first sentence we were talking about psychosocial, and as soon as you take the phrase psycho, the people are stepping back and say, oh, well, psycho, this is not my topic at all. There we have the psychologist and the safety guys and the health management guys in place. And I think this is something we need to work on. And this is what I mentioned earlier. We have to make this topic much more transparent. And what is psychosocial risk management or psychosocial topics per se all about? And I think we need to spend much more efforts on make it more transparent. So we cannot work on the same topic if we don't speak the same language. This is essential for me.
Okay, if you can switch your microphones up. Turning to Deutsche Post, can you talk about your leadership and mental health web-based training program and how in that you attempted to address these, potentially these issues of stigma or people's perception of what mental health issues are?
Yeah, this is a clear aim of the web-based training, to take away the stigma from mental health, or from not mental health, mental illness. But it's still a challenging issue. We just had a big debate on a patient congress 1 month ago with about 1,000 depressive people. And the reality in a lot of companies is still that there is a fear to handle these topics of depressions. It is depression when we are talking about mental illness. On one hand, we recommend every employee with a depression to be open to his or her managers, but we still ask the people who suffer from a depression, from the health experts' view, if they could expect from their managers to be open, or is there perhaps a clear hurdle to talk to the manager. It's still, the recommendation is in the company, I think, and we have this open mood to discuss the topic depression freely, but on the other side, there are sometimes some hurdles, and this is still an individual question to overcome these hurdles. The recommendation is be 100% clear, but sometimes it could be in the consequence a problem when there is a manager who fears this illness. It's still a challenge.
Okay, what's the experience of the audience? Because how many of you, we can't use a voting pad, but how many of you still feel that this, that depression and stress has stigma attached to it? So we can put your hands up. Okay. And how many don't think it's got stigma attached, obviously? Right. And there's some that are in between. I mean, do you have any personal comments or questions regarding stigma? It's we've got hands up. Good. Excellent. That gives us a chance to breathe and take some water.
Arratsaldeon, buenas tardes. Voy a hablar en castellano. Son dos preguntas que me han ido surgiendo a lo largo de la intervención de los diferentes ponentes. No tienen que ver directamente con el estigma, pero sí me gustaría formularlas. Una de ellas es, en las empresas en las que hoy hemos estado viendo cómo se han desarrollado políticas a favor de un mejor clima laboral, me gustaría saber esas plantillas, esas personas sobre las que se incide y con las que se trabaja, qué porcentaje de ellas tienen una estabilidad en las empresas y qué porcentaje de ellas son personal que fluctúa con contratos temporales. Esto lo pregunto porque normalmente se nos dice que en la empresa dentro del Estado español tenemos plantillas muy amplias de personas fijas, mientras que en otros países de Europa esto es diferente. Entonces, si es así, pues me maravilla, me sorprende que además seamos capaces de avanzar en este tipo de políticas de mejora del clima de trabajo. Bueno, esa era la primera pregunta y luego ya formularé alguna otra. Gracias.
Okay, so the question is what percentage of people are in secure jobs or stable jobs versus what percentage of people are in zero-hour contracts or type of jobs where there is no, the security is not there, and what the implications might be for people's health and well-being. And that was in my best Spanish translation in my ear, so hopefully that is correct. Is that correct? Yes, I'm getting acknowledgement that is correct. Would anyone like to start?
Yeah, in my case, it's around 90%, I think, that is in stable jobs, and only 10% that is contemporary. So, but I can't say that there's any difference among the way that they react on the programs. So, basically, I think it's almost the same.
I cannot tell you the clear percentage, but knowing the situation in Germany with about 200,000 employees, most of them have a clear and a long-term contract. I think the biggest problem are not the people with the time contract. It's a question of the outsourcing, the subcontractor business, which is more and more, especially in the logistics business, the situation. But also in this topic, the companies, and especially Deutsche Post DHL, is engaged to include the subcontractors into the setting of a healthy and safe workplace. But this is still a challenge, but it's clearly addressed in the company guidelines to include the subcontractors' strategy also on the topic of health and safety.
Well, I just want to go any further. What's the definition of a safe job? I mean, it's not a secret that we're talking about always talking about the global economy and that we are experiencing a greater pace of global change nowadays. So I think it's a reality that we cannot deny that the safe, if you mean, by safe, if you mean working for 20, 30 years for the same company, I don't know, it's still possible in the near future or in a completely changing environment, changing technologies, changing world. I don't know. Maybe it's possible, but safe if you work on a temporary contract or you work for a...
Yeah, I mean, I think it's interesting because certainly within the UK, the large proportion of new jobs have zero-hour contracts. And what we are finding is that people are experiencing lack of control because they don't know what to expect. They're getting peaks in demands and they're getting troughs in demands because, again, they don't know in terms of work what their expectation is. So the idea that zero-hour contracts were there to benefit the employee, in reality, it's not been the case. It's been the opposite. It causes insecurity. It causes a sense of not knowing if I can come into work. We know people that turn up, travel an hour on a bus or a train, to be told that there is no work that day, and they travel back. So the insecurity of that, and that's not just in the UK, that's in other countries that we see, will create, you know, problems with demands and particularly control. Okay, I'm going to ask the man in the red jumper. Yes, if someone can give him a microphone. Thank you. But I will come back to the lady who asked the question because I know she's got another question.
Thank you. Is it okay? Yeah. My name is Lothar Lissner, Kooperationsstelle Hamburg. We have been doing a lot of interviews in micro and small enterprises. For the agency, we are just running a study in the hotel, restaurant, and catering sector. And I'm very impressed about this. Many interviews with non-specialists in OSH with a completely different understanding. And I have two questions. One more positive and one a little provocative. The first one is, do you have any tips for these enterprises below 50 people? And the second one is, do you feel a little bit responsible as a larger enterprise that you outsourced many of these stressful jobs, catering, security, cleaning, all these unstable, low-paid jobs. The construction of a new building is made by another enterprise with less stable and less, how do you say, kuschelig, cozy working conditions. Yeah, isn't that a too good picture if you don't see the whole value chain or supply chain, if you look only at the core and not at the surrounding, let's say, less well-treated.
I'll let the one or two panelists answer that question, and then I will give my answer from not from one of the organisations, but from my understanding of my work that I do with SMEs in Europe and in the UK. Good luck. Over to you, Andreas.
At first, we see your question from two aspects, because on one hand, we have outsourced some of the jobs you have mentioned, like cleaning. On the other side, we are doing outsourced jobs in our logistics business sometimes, but with people with long-term contracts normally. Regarding the question of the small or medium-sized enterprise, I see sometimes, or I feel that the debate is not really clear, because we often say that this small and medium-sized enterprises must have a problem in designing healthy workplaces. And what I see always, also in my with my friends who are sometimes small entrepreneurs with some employees. The communication is much more clear. The interest of the bosses is sometimes much more feasible. They often try to help their employees in question of debt or other things. But what they need is expert help, what we have in the bigger companies. And so what we see in Germany, currently we have a new legislation, legislation on prevention, where the small and medium-sized enterprises are in the focus of so-called regional coordination centers, where the health insurances, sometimes accident insurances, have a special role together with universities, perhaps of occupational health, to address the expert knowledge on a very easy base, together with the regional networks of small and medium enterprises, to address this expert knowledge to the people. But what I sometimes see, what we lack as a big company, is the clear communication. And this is a big advantage in the small and medium-sized enterprises. So there are two aspects.
Lars?
Yeah, to your point in regard to small and medium-sized companies and how to get support or tips, I know that, for instance, Deutsche Berufsgenossenschaft is having, they have a concept especially focusing on managing psychosocial risks. And I know there are also another, I don't know how many agencies available in Germany that are providing really support to the small and medium size, because they don't have the in-house expertise. I know that because we had the EU benchmarking event two weeks ago in Berlin, and there was a representative from the Berufsgenossenschaft in Germany, especially introducing this support. So the small and medium-sized companies are not left alone. Of course, they don't have the expertise in-house, but they can get support externally, for sure. And to your point, outsourcing the stressful jobs, I don't think that the argument for sourcing something out is whether it is stressful or less stressful. There are, let's say, other aspects why companies decide to outsource certain activities or jobs. But it is not because it is a stressful part. I'm absolutely sure there are other aspects or reasons why they do it. It is not because they want to get rid of the stressful work. For sure not, because we still have it. So.
Keld, please.
Yeah. About the tips below 50, I think, as I already mentioned, that you have to establish a common language. You have to make sure that everybody knows what they are talking about work, about stress, and so on. And one thing that I think is even more important, that you have to make it easy. You have to be open. You have to establish some kind of trust, because what people are afraid of is losing their job, be stigmatized. And the workplaces have to open up and say, better that you come and tell us it, instead of getting very sick of it. So you have to establish some kind of trust, and you need to establish a common language. And I think one thing that is very important too, it doesn't mean that the worker or the employee can't go to work. I think it's very important that if you get in a situation where people are getting sick of coming to work, we don't need to put them aside and let them be back home, because we are some kind of group animal. We need to be together, we need to be recognized, we need to be seen. So a part of the healing process is also to be together with the colleagues and be on the workplace. So we have to broaden our perspective. We have to make people understand what is in play, what do we need to do to overcome it and make the common language. I'm totally into the outsourcing part, because in bank the core of our work is banking, so establishing people who can build our buildings and so on won't be a part of our call. And I don't think that we will. We do it because of the stress. We do it because we don't know how to do it.
Commenting briefly. In my experience of working with SMEs, their ability to tackle the problem is quicker because they're closer to the issues. So for example, one of our award winners, the Hotel Conlon in Barcelona, 78 employees, they have a clear strategy where people bring issues to meetings, solutions are generated by staff, and they're implemented, and that's why they were recognized, because they show that you can actually do this as an SME. There is an element of corporate social responsibility on larger organizations when actioning smaller organizations to provide services. And I believe actually a company who has health and well-being at the heart of what they will do can build that into their procurement contracts and in the services that they go to others to provide. So just because you're a small catering company, it doesn't mean that the organization that's buying in your service can't actually recommend that you do certain practices and that you look after your people. So I think there's a great strength in larger organizations actually create, you know, making smaller organizations have better working practices. But also the reality for me is many SMEs are better at managing these issues than bigger organizations. And within every large organization, you have a division. Within a division, you have a unit. Within a unit, you have a team. And within a team, you have a group of co-workers. At every angle of that organization, from the unit down, is an SME. People function in teams like as an SME. So I believe that you can make a difference at the small level or the micro level. Are there any more questions? Look at the hand at the back. Excellent.
Peter, can I add something?
Oh, and Andreas wants to add something.
Right word. In Germany, it's especially the role of the Chamber of Handcrafts or a Chamber of Crafts. To link them together with the health insurances and sometimes the accident insurances. And I see now a new danger on the horizon, because with the new legislation on prevention, everybody who never was really engaged in prevention of for example, mental diseases is now engaged. It's like the accident insurance, the health insurance, rental insurance or pension insurance. They know all, they say, we are the real actors in the prevention setting. And you will see that now different agencies will come to the small and medium-sized enterprises, because this is one focus in this prevention law. And the question is, who is really responsible for what? Because this, I think this will change very, very fast, but we will still have some challenges.
Lady at the back.
Hello, thanks for this session, which is very inspiring. I work for a EU agency based in Turin, Italy, and I work for HR. We as HR unit were in charge of the work-related stress risk assessment, and I realized, and it has become very evident from your words, that for instance, the management was not involved in this assessment, whether because the management was not aware of this risk, so the work-related stress risk, or maybe because they didn't want to be aware of it, because in some cases they thought that our approach as HR unit to submit questionnaires and checklists about the work-related stress risk assessment was a way to promote the problem and to increase the problem rather than to fight against it. So my question is there a way, or do you have any tips in order that we as HR unit involve the management in this discussion, because it's very important that also the management is aware of it, and we realize that the management was not aware of it. Thanks.
Hands up. Anyone?
Yeah. I mean, you're probably not the only company that is facing the challenge, but I can tell you the most important thing that works is having the commitment of the top management, and this is exactly the way we are doing it. Yeah, forget about starting at site level or middle management level if the top management is not fully committed. And maybe you need to convince them by business cases at the end of the day, however you need to do so. This is at least my experience, and it works fine. So there's no excuse for the line management anymore, at least in our company, because we have the full and clear commitment of the Siemens board, and they are saying, guys, this is your responsibility as a manager, and there's no way out at the end of the day. So this is what you should strive for, to get really the commitment from the top management, and they can then cascade it further down to site level or department level at the end of the day.
And another tip from me is get it into the balance scorecard, get it into the evaluation of the line management, how they accomplish the surveys. And another thing that we have been doing is just to call them. If the department doesn't answer on the survey, we call them and ask them why. And that they have to do it because we need to know what is going on. So I think that we, as a human resource department, should go a little further to pressure, to make them understand why this is very important. And then, of course, I'm totally in with Lars. If you can get the top level management to also make a pressure, you'll be well off.
Maybe another tip from my side. We have another program called Zero Harm Culture at Siemens, which is about behavior at the end of the day. And when we decided to deploy it in 2012, there was a discussion whether it should be mandatory within the corporation or whether it is on a voluntary base. And surprisingly, we decided not to make it mandatory. And there were discussions around saying, guys, you want to change the culture within your organization and you don't make it mandatory. We said, yes, intentionally. We do it not mandatory. We don't make it mandatory, because if somebody is not really convinced that it absolutely makes sense, even if you would do it mandatory, they would just do the minimum. It would never ever fly. So, and just to prevent this, we said, no, guys, we take the good examples, and you always have in an organization. You always have somebody who is a front runner, who is a volunteer, who is acting as a pilot, and this is exactly what we did. So. We're just taking the success stories and promoted them globally. And this had a huge effect, a huge positive effect, because then suddenly other managers see, well, they can't be all stupid. They don't just spend resources on a topic where there is no return on invest, if you want to put it this way. So we were promoting actively the good practices and the success stories. And it still goes on.
I would recommend to work on every level which is possible. Yes, I agree, we need the attention and the commitment of our top management. If you have a top management, or if there's a company without this commitment of the top management, you can try to convince the management, for example, with these business cases, or the compliance colleagues, if there is a compliance department regarding the legal obligations, regarding the risk assessment. If this does not work, you have to engage in guerrilla work, and then you have to address the line managers, and perhaps we have some line managers with problems, with people who suffer from mental illnesses and depressions, and if you then can build up this success cases to support these line managers, You can convince the top management afterwards, because if you can demonstrate from the operating success from the operating business, every top manager will go with you afterwards. So, but normally, I think we all know we have to play on these different levels to be successful on the long way. And it depends always on the structure of the companies, but never give up. And sometimes you have to work as a guerrilla, but you will survive.
So shortly, we're going to be finishing. Before we finish, I'd like to say thank you to all the speakers, if you could thank them. Excellent. Next slide. Oh, there we are. That will do, that will be fine. When we started out on this journey in looking at psychosocial risk, over 18 months ago, and we were looking for good practice examples, many people would have said, well, do they exist? Are they out there? Are companies really interested in managing people's psychosocial risk? Part of the campaign and part of being the good practice jury is we saw examples of excellence. We saw examples of sustainability. We saw examples where people could intervene and make a difference to people's lives and to change people's lives. And they weren't just multinationals. They were SMEs. They were a steel company. They were hotels. It was a cross-section of companies within Europe. And I think that's really, really important. I've been extremely proud to have been able to be a part of this process, and it's reinvigorated my sense of passion for this area, which is actually the legacy for this campaign should be that we go out into our workplaces and we make psychosocial risk the normal practice. We assess psychosocial risk, we look to reduce psychosocial risk. Do not let anyone tell you you can't do anything because it's psychological or it's social or it's in your head. You can do things as a company that make a real difference to people's lives. And most of these examples that you've seen can be applied across a variety of organizations. Do not let the legacy of this conference just be that we've done this, nothing else happens afterwards, because people across Europe are experiencing work-related stress at high numbers as we speak. And we have the tools, we have the ability to make a difference to those lives. So let's go from here and take these good practice examples that you have and start applying them in your organization. Okay, thank you very much. And we finished dead on 6 o'clock.